Porsche. It's a company that's famously pretty good at motorsport. But what happens to all those racing cars when they retire? Well, they end up here. And you can see a lot here. As long as there have been Porsches, there have been people out there racing them, mainly because they're extremely fast and very reliable. Probably two things that are quite useful in a racing car. Ah, and you see this? This is the granddaddy of them all, because this is a Porsche 550 Spyder. Now, technically, this is Porsche's first ever production racing car. And just look at it. It's so simple, so beautiful, so lightweight looking. And if you look inside, this one's been restored. So it's a little bit perfect. It's not in period, but everything is just so simple. Tiny little bucket seats, race harnesses, wooden steering wheel, manual gearbox. The thing is, this is only technically Porsche's first production racing car, because people were racing 356 SLs way before this. Told you it was going to get geeky. Amazing, isn't it? This is Porsche's kind of not so secret retirement village for all those ex-racy things, all tucked up for a little bit of a rest. But this place is actually pretty big, so I'm going to have a poke around and see what I can see. Ah, there's too much here. I'm going to have to try and pick out some favourites. And I have seen something I love just over there. Come with me. Now, I know a lot of people would head straight for the Le Mans cars, but I've seen this and it's game over, because this is my favorite Porsche ever. It is obviously the 959 Dakar. Now, this is basically from my age, so a little bit older, but I remember this went out in the Dakar in 1985. With a naturally aspirated 3.2 litre boxer, so an engine that was quite normal, and it bombed, didn't come anywhere. Then it went out in 86 with a 2.8 litre turbo and came first and second. It was a bit of a game changer. But look at it. This one's got all the period bits on it. It just looks fabulous. It was four-wheel drive. It had sophisticated PSK sort of torque biasing and traction control and all sorts of things that other cars didn't have. That's what made it so successful. There's one thing I've never seen, though, is the inside of one. Come and have a look. Ooh. Oh, smells of Dakar and petrol and glue. That's a really strong smell. Like all good race cars, plenty of gaffer tape and bits holding it together, because this looks like it's been left quite in period. It's just fascinating. So carbon buckets. It's got like a road car gear stick, 5-speed manual, but then there's loads of switches and fuel pump things, and like it had long range tanks, and you can see on the dash that it's got things for fuel pumps, but you can switch between the two big tanks, fuses. It's got a normal like 911 dash that we're used to, but like all good sort of race cars, everything's just been like this Tippex pointing at things, and those little punch labeling things everywhere. This is just so cool. Obviously it's got a roll cage and stuff, but it's the smell that's doing it for me. Like it smells like a race car. And weirdly, these cars, 959s, were originally intended for Group B rallying, but before it got ready enough to compete, Group B got banned as being too fast and too dangerous. So the 959 went on to be like one of the most sophisticated road cars of its day. But also, you know that four-wheel drive system that it had, it was called PSK. Well, that ended up being developed and refined for all turbo road cars that we've got to this day. How's that for legacy? Still smells great though. But that's not even the coolest thing about the 959. Because this is a 959 reimagined as an endurance racer. Now, it's not technically a 959, it was codenamed 961, but this is the car taken away and made for track work. So the car's lower, obviously, it's wider, it's got a lot more aero than the Dakar car. But interestingly, the 961 actually went to Le Mans in about 1986, I want to say, and it won its class, which makes the 959 actually one of the very few cars I can think of that's won at endurance racing at Le Mans and also won at rallying at Dakar. That is pretty cool. Turbo. Turbo. Twin turbo. This is a 356, again, early 60s, but this is an Abarth Porsche. So back in the day, Porsche wasn't very good at aluminium bodywork, but Turin, Abarth were really good at it. So Porsche farmed out 356 to be rebodied, and that is the result. Le Mans car from the year 2000. The V10 out of that ended up in the Carrera GT. Quite literally the boss. And it's got the big man's name on the side. Super cool. I've been completely left alone in here. Nobody seems bothered and I can do what I like. So I'm gonna have a look at some cars. And I remember this because I remember the livery. Look at this. So these are made externally, but oh my God, look at it. Look how low it is. That would be a real ankle biter, wouldn't it? But that is an iconic shape, really iconic. Oh, look at this, look at this.
This is an RS Spyder, which Porsche raced in the American Le Mans series in the 2000s. Arriving a few years after the Porsche canned the V10 LMP 2000 racer to spend the cash on Cayenne development, this smaller Spyder competed in the LMP2 category up against the all-conquering LMP1 Audis. Nonetheless, it still nabbed plenty of overall victories. It went on to win its category at the Le Mans 24 Hours too, and in a slightly bigger form, its engine ended up in the 918 Spyder. And that engine now has twin turbos and powers the latest 963 hypercar.
Isn't that awesome? Timo Bernhard and Romain Dumas. That looks mad. Look at the steering wheel. You thought Tesla had a yoke steering wheel before anyone else, but they didn't. And it's tiny. It's like the width of my hand. That's bizarre. I didn't realize they look like that. What else is down here? I don't even know what's under here. Oh, quite a famous car again. Oh, there's lots of like 962s and stuff. These are all endurance races, Le Mans cars, things like that. But some of them are open and some of them are closed. And then you get random things like this.
This 804 gave Porsche its only F1 win as a constructor in the 1962 French Grand Prix, and it came with a 177 brake horsepower 1.5-litre flat 8 engine, with the fuel tanks in the nose and side by side with the cockpit. Only four cars were ever built, and this is one of them.
I mean, there's nothing to it. It's just a tube. I think these are aluminium. Yeah, aluminium bodied, so you basically, there's a bit of padding in here that looks like a seat, and then a tube chassis and a load of aluminium panels. But if you crashed one of these, this became your coffin because there's no safety. And they'd be pretty quick. I mean, these are, oh, there, look. It's rear mid engine, but the fan's in the top, so it sucks in cold air from the top. Just beautiful, simple, pure pieces of engineering. And everything else gets a bit more complicated as it gets older, so things get faster and, you know, they need more cooling and more brakes and more technology. But there's everywhere, everywhere. Look here. Oh my goodness. Look at that. That's really cool. That's really cool.
This is the 917/10 RC Cola, Porsche's first full-scale attempt at Can-Am back in the early 1970s. It ran a 5-litre flat 12 and was modified with a couple of turbos. It was not lacking in power.
It's very low, but look how big that rear wing is. It looks like a cartoon of a racing car. Oh, this is weird. It's got no livery. What's this one? Oh, I think I know what this is. Now, this is a very odd 917 that never really raced, which is probably why it's got no livery. Looks amazing, by the way, with just white. You can really see the shape because it's not got like racing stripes and all sorts of things on it. But the most interesting thing about this car isn't necessarily the fact that it's got no livery. Look at this. What's in here? Now that, look at how complicated that looks just from standing above it. This is a V16 917. And it was something that Porsche was working on to get loads of horsepower. Look at the two dizzy caps. Look how many spark plug leads. This thing's mental. It was originally made from a 12-cylinder that had four more cylinders kind of bolted to the end of it to make a V16. Back in the day, this was making about 1,200 horsepower. And that is in a car that doesn't weigh that much. And it just looks super, super complicated. It's got plastic intake trumpets, which are covered by these covers. But this is an amazing bit of kit. And the weird thing about this is, this car was actually killed by turbocharging. So this was about 6.5 litres V16, made about 1,200 horsepower in Qualitrim. And because you could get so much more power out of a smaller engine with turbos, these big bangers fell by the wayside. So this car never actually went off and did anything in particular. It's been run, it works, but it never had a racing career. But seeing it looks vintage. It looks really vintage. And then you look into the cockpit and it's almost like a joke. There's a tiny leather wrapped steering wheel, and then the gear shifter is on the right hand side, little bucket seat, and then a wooden gear knob for extra lightness. This is purity. Just drink it in. Ah, it doesn't stop, does it? Look at this. So this is a 935. This was probably born the same year I was, 1976, and it went racing like a mad thing, won loads of stuff, including Le Mans. Just like a caricature of a car. It's got big aero, big intakes. It was a 3.3 litre boxer six with a big turbo, so loads of turbo lag. And they made about 850 brake horsepower, and despite it looking quite fat, this car probably weighs about a ton. So imagine driving that at Le Mans. You've got 850 brake horsepower, massive turbo lag. You only weigh a ton, so you can go around corners pretty quick. 935s went on to do all sorts of stuff because nobody really sold customer cars to the public like Porsche did. So privateers could get hold of them and race them. They just had this vibe of being outlandish, and I remember these as a kid thinking they look super, super cool. They had brilliant liveries, obviously. This is the Martini one, pretty famous, but they also had, I remember, Jägermeister. Come to think of it, booze did feature quite heavily back in the 70s. But just look at this, it looks mad. It's got leather straps on the windscreen for some reason. This is mad. Jochen Mass and Jackie Ickx sat here, and it's almost like a vintage car. It feels so basic. But the best bit about the 935 and Porsches subsequently is that the rev counter's twisted so that the top of the rev range is always in your sight. This is just awesome. And if you want a bit more modern Porsche motorsport, then there's obviously these. These are 919 hybrids. They're just sort of put down the side of the workshop. But these are interesting because they're extremely successful in racing. They went at Le Mans again. Again, Porsche seems to like Le Mans. They won in, 3 years on the trot? So 2015, 2016, 2017. The interesting thing about these cars is that they're extremely complex, but they obviously are very reliable because they've won Le Mans. So they only have a 2 litre four-cylinder engine, right? It makes about 500 horsepower. It's got a single turbo. And that is also assisted by a couple of lithium ion batteries and electric motors. And they're fed by two different energy recovery systems. So one's fed by exhaust gases, a bit like a reverse turbo kind of thing. And then the other one is kinetic, so brakes and things. But the engine sits in here. So if you look at this one, the engine's only about here, and it's a stressed member. So the front of the car and the back of the car are linked by the engine, and they're attached by 16 bolts. Can you imagine doing 24 hours of racing where your engine is part of your chassis and the only connections are 16 bolts? You've got to really trust the people who make your bolts, in my opinion. Very, very successful car, quite complicated. But then when the rules changed and LMP1 changed and Porsche wasn't going to campaign this car anymore, in 2018, the gloves came off, and we got that. So this is a 919 Hybrid Evo. And what that means is Porsche basically said, screw the rules, we're going to build whatever we can to make it the fastest car ever. So it's de-restricted, it has better aero. That four-cylinder engine that's in the middle that was 500 horsepower became 700 horsepower. It's got far more energy recovery, so it can charge its batteries faster. It had about 50% better aero, so this car was a lot more slippery through the air, a lot more efficient on fast circuits. And then Porsche just decided to go out and bust records. So it went to Spa-Francorchamps and beat the F1 car lap record. And this is a car that went round the Nürburgring in 5 minutes, 19 seconds, right? If you go and watch that onboard footage on YouTube, genuinely, it looks sped up. It's absolutely awesome. One of the modern 935s. Now, this is probably one of the few cars here that I actually have driven, and that's parked next to a load of 911 race cars. RSR, massive wings. GT3R Hybrid, which is an interesting one. RSR, lots of purple. And then an RSR. Brilliant. To be honest, I'm kind of emotionally exhausted just walking around here. I mean, there's so many beautiful cars, but it's not just that. Each one has a beautiful history attached to it. Imagine what it was like sitting in one of these and racing it. And the best bit is that Porsche is keeping this as a heritage collection so it can learn from the past to inform its own future. As secret stashes go, this one is pretty epic. And now all I need to do is get them to give me the keys to that 959 Dakar.